Penguin Random House Audio presents Still Life by Skip Hollandsworth from Texas Monthly, May 2009. Read for you by Ashley Wood. Compared with the glistening two-story mansions that surrounded it, the house looked like something from another time. It was only 2,180 square feet. Its red brick exterior was crumbling, and its gutters were clogged with leaves. Faded, paint-chipped blinds sagged behind the front windows. Next to the concrete steps leading to the front door, a scraggly banana plant clung to life. Built in 1950, it was one of the last of the original single-story homes on Northport Drive in Dallas's Preston Hollow neighborhood. The newer residents, almost all of them affluent baby boomers, had no idea who lived there. Over the years, they'd see an ambulance pull up to the front of the house, and they'd watch as paramedics carried out someone covered in a blanket. A few days later, they'd see the paramedics return to carry that person back inside. But they'd never learned who it was or what had happened. Some of the local kids were convinced that the house was haunted. They'd ride their bikes by the lot at dusk, daring one another to ring the doorbell or run across the unwatered lawn. None of the neighbors knew that mailmen once delivered boxes of letters to the front door and that strangers left plates of food or envelopes stuffed with money. They didn't know that high school kids, whenever they drove past the house, blew their horns over and over. They didn't know that a church youth group had stood on that front yard one afternoon, faced the house, and sung a hymn. In fact, it wasn't until the spring of last year that they learned that the little house used to be one of Dallas's most famous residences, known throughout the city as the McClamrock House. It was the home of Anne McClamrock and her son John, the boy who could not move. On the morning of October 17, 1973, John McClamrock bounded out of bed, threw on bell-bottom jeans and a loud, patterned shirt with an oversized collar, jumped into his red El Camino with a vinyl roof, and raced off to Hillcrest High School, only six blocks away. He was 17 years old, and according to one girl who had dated him, he was the all-American boy, just heartbreakingly beautiful. He had china blue eyes and wavy black hair that fell over his forehead, and when he smiled, dimples creased his cheeks. Sometimes, when he sacked groceries at the neighborhood Tom Thumb, Hillcrest girls would show up to buy watermelons so that he'd carry them out to their cars. On weekend nights, they'd head for Forest Lane, the cruising spot for Dallas teenagers, hoping to get a look at him in his El Camino, or better yet, catch a ride. One cute Hillcrest blonde, Sarah Ole, had been lucky enough to go out with John on her first ever car date to play miniature golf. After he took her home, she called all her friends and told them she had had trouble breathing the entire time they were together. That morning, John sat restlessly through his classes. When the lunch period bell rang, he drove to the nearest Burger King to grab a Whopper. He pushed buttons on the radio until he found the Allman Brothers' Ramblin' Man, turned up the volume, and pressed down on the gas pedal to get back to school. He walked past the auditorium, where the drama club was rehearsing Neil Simon's Plaza Suite, made a left turn, and then walked on toward the boys' locker room to put on his football uniform. John, or Clam, as he was known among his friends, had a game that afternoon. Earlier that summer, John had quit playing for the Hillcrest Panthers so he could work extra hours at Tom Thumb to pay off his El Camino. When he tried to rejoin the team at the start of his junior year, the coaches had ordered him to spend a few weeks on the JV squad. He was 5 feet 11 inches tall and weighed 160 pounds. He played tackle on offense, linebacker on defense, and he was the wedge buster on the kickoffs, assigned the task of breaking up the other team's front line of blockers. That afternoon, the junior varsity was playing Spruce High School, and John was determined to show the coaches what he could do. This was the week, he vowed to his buddies, that he would be promoted to varsity. On Hillcrest's opening kickoff, he burst through the Spruce blockers and zeroed in on the ball carrier. He lowered his head, and as the two collided, John's chin caught the runner's thigh. The sound, one teammate later said, was like a tree trunk breaking in half. John's head snapped back, and he fell face first to the ground. For the next several seconds, another teammate recalled, there was nothing but a terrible silence. Because there were no cell phones in that era, a coach had one of the players run to the high school's main office to call an ambulance. When it arrived 15 minutes later, John was still on the ground, his body strangely still. You've got some pinched nerves, a referee told him, speaking into the earhole of his helmet. You'll be up in no time. But as soon as he was wheeled into Presbyterian Hospital, doctors knew he was in trouble. They gave him a complete neurological exam, scraping a pencil across the bottoms of his feet and taking x-rays. Then ordered that his head be shaved and two small holes be bored into the top of his skull. Large tongs, like the ones used to carry blocks of ice, were attached to the holes, and 70 pounds of weight was hung from the tongs in an attempt to realign his spine. A Hillcrest administrator called John's mother at her office at a local bank. Anne McClamrock was 54 years old, a striking woman, green-eyed with strawberry blonde hair. She was, as her niece liked to say, perpetually good-natured. She always had extra food in the refrigerator for the neighborhood kids who came running in and out of the house, and on weekends, she loved to throw boisterous dinner parties, most of them ending with her exhorting everyone around the table to sing corny old songs like Skinamarink. When she arrived at the hospital, a doctor took her aside and quietly asked if she had any religious preference. I'm Catholic, Anne said, giving him a bewildered look. Maybe you should call your priest in case you need to deliver your son his last rites, the doctor said. We're not sure he's going to make it through the night. The doctor told Anne that John had severely damaged his spinal cord and was paralyzed from his neck down. He was able to swivel his head from side to side, but because his circulatory system had been disrupted, causing his blood pressure to fluctuate wildly, he could not lift his head without blacking out. It couldn't be any worse, the doctor said. At least outwardly, Anne seemed to take the diagnosis rather calmly. Or maybe, she later told her friends, she had simply been unable to comprehend the full meaning of what the doctor was saying. She stood at her son's bedside until her husband, Mac, who had been out of town that day, he worked for a company that insured 18-wheelers, arrived with the McClamrock's other child, Henry, a quiet boy who was a freshman at Hillcrest. It was right then, with the family all together, that Anne felt the tears coming. She slowly turned to the doctor, her hands trembling. My Johnny is not going to die, she said. You wait and see. He's going to have a good life. And then, her voice choking, she fell into Mac's arms. John made it through the night, and then through the next day. His friends flocked to the hospital, many of them dropped off at the front door by their parents. One night, nearly 100 kids were in the ICU waiting room, all of them signing their names on a makeshift guest register, a legal pad, pinned to a wall. There were so many phone calls coming into the hospital about John that extra operators were brought in to work the switchboard. The local newspapers jumped on the story, and soon just about everyone in Dallas was following John's struggle to stay alive. Dallas Cowboys coach Tom Landry and star defensive back Charlie Waters came to see him. The owner of the local Bonanza Steakhouse chain held a Johnny McClamrock Day, donating 10% of all the restaurant sales to a medical fund. Buy a drink for Johnny booths were set up at shopping malls all over the city, with proceeds from the $1 soft drinks going to the family. And at Hillcrest alone, there was a bake sale, a benefit basketball game, a bowl-a-thon, a 50s dance, and even a paper drive conducted by the Ecology Club. After one of the National Wire Services ran a story about John, letters began pouring in from all over the country.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.